We gave Adam a job. Think of a podcast idea, Adam. So he spent all of, I don't know, 2 seconds?
Yeah, something like that.
And went top 10 music.
My name is El Nino. I'm hanging out, drinking in the back of El Camino. As a kid, was a skid. No one knew my name.
Our first dance song was called Who Let the Dogs Out by the Baha Men.
Who Let the Dogs Out?
Busted, the Beatles, Justin Bieber, they're all up there.
Hi, I'm Adam.
And I'm Josh.
And welcome back to the Break Bread Podcast, where I want to start this week just by being quite sincere, which is not my normal default setting, in saying that thanks to everyone for listening and or watching, because although I don't, I'm basically just an employee, right? I just come here when Josh tells me to. So I don't spend a lot of time in the analytics, but I'm told a lot of people are listening and watching, which is a surprise to me, given how ramshackle it all is and Josh's abject lack of charisma, but people are listening and watching. So thank you very much. How have you been this week?
Can I also take this opportunity to second that thanks? You are very active in the comment section on YouTube. That has to be said. That is quite nice. I am genuinely shocked every week at how many comments we get and how nice the comments are. It is really nice.
Broadly, they're not all nice, but
yeah,
that's some of the not nice ones are actually. They're not better, but they're humorous at least. So yeah,
we've got to take the positive with the negative, and you know, work on us shortcomings.
Yeah, working out our shortcomings. Yeah. What are we starting off? We're starting off with the YouTube comments thing.
As always, mate. Look at this. He's like a professional now. He knows exactly what's going on. Yeah, YouTube comments.
It's time for a YouTube comment from you.
All right. So first comment we've got, Mr. Adam. Stop texting your fucking nan. It's rude.
I'm getting prepared because you told me I've got to read. Yeah. I've got to pull my own weight, right?
That was a comment. That was a comment, actually, that somebody said, is one of the guests going to be your nan? But I forget who put it.
She couldn't get up the stairs.
John McKay has said, I enjoy the show as it is with just you two geezers, but looking forward to some of the guests being mentioned. Randy seems fun and Matt Armstrong comes across as a stand-up kind of guy. Your role play for asking Pixielot on all... You're fucking hell. Your role play for asking Pixielot on almost seemed worse than inappropriately asking a strange child to exchange food for money.
Of those two interactions, if the Pixielot one were real, I got a lot of support about that. If you haven't listened to that episode, just to give you some context, I didn't just approach a child and say, can I buy your meal off you, your in-flight meal? And a lot of people agreed with me and said what I did was not, I was not in the wrong. I was trying to do the right thing. Admittedly, it may have come across as a bit strange. It doesn't happen every day, but I got a lot of support for that. Comment number two is from Burn So Good. And it's actually a quotation of when you said, hey, big dick blue ticks coming in, yeah, boy. Which was, I think, Josh's attempt at insulting me for alleging that when I wanted to do a food challenge, right, yeah. They wouldn't let me film. He was trying to suggest that I'm egotistical and was like, oh, do you know who I am? And that's not actually what
I want to know where that actually comes from in my head, because I don't remember saying that. I don't remember the one talk.
The fact that you're constantly thinking about dicks. We've established that already on this podcast.
All right, next one is the last one as well. He's from Pratt's on Film. So I like this one.
That could be the name of this podcast.
We're going for a comment readout hard. So here it goes. Beard, do you ever sit on the pavements and dangle your legs over the edge? Genuinely love your stuff, boys, but we've been brewing on that one for a while. Great episode. Loves Beard's pond crossing adventures too. Thumbs up. That's a fucking
Beard's pond crossing.
Pond crossing.
Oh yeah. No, thanks. What was that guy's name?
Pratt's on film.
So it could be a collective. Could be a man. Could be a woman.
I reckon it's a team. It's a team of people that have, like I said, they're going in. They wanted that comment readout. I wholeheartedly approve of that. There's the thought of little Beard just dangling his feet. These are all like amazing t-shirt ideas, aren't they? Don't you think? Like a little caricature. Mate,
I think if we need, if the coffee has taught us anything, it's that merchandise is not our avenue of expertise. But yeah, thanks for the comments, folks. And I think we should pay lip service as well to the guest we had last week, Brian Lacey. I really enjoyed that one. It was the most I think I've laughed on a on a podcast.
You were quick, weren't you? When you went to shut him down at the beginning, calling him a pound stretcher Joe Rogan.
It was good to have somebody who's got that kind of elite level of quick thinking. Normally, you're like, you know, in The Simpsons, where they call Homer slow, and he's like, somebody said I was slow, and it's actually like 15 hours later that he's realised they've called him slow when he was playing poker earlier on. That's what it's like having a conversation with you.
Here we go.
I'm only joking. Right, how have you been? Let's get the incidentals out of the way first of all.
Yeah, I've been all right. I've been up to Newcastle this week. I've been filming up there.
Must have been good because you've been singing all morning. You've been very jovial.
I mean, weirdly, those that are listening and watching, Adam walked through the door of the office this morning with a grin on his face, ear to ear, which you might think, oh, he's a jolly guy when you see him on camera, but you know full well the podcast OGs know he's a right miserable bastard. So when he walked in grinning, me and George were like, what's going on here? Have you got laid this morning? Like, what happened?
I'm not a morning glory kind of guy, mate. No. No, I was trying to bring the... You make I'm a tyrant. I'm not really. I'm having a good morning. I don't know. I was happy to talk. We're talking about music today, aren't we? We're talking about music. So I don't know. I was content to get to it. I didn't realize I was going to have to help set up all the stuff and lug all the shit up from the van, but you know.
Well, yeah, we set a time to record today, and Adam decided to come 2 hours early. I think you just want to get out of the house. What was your reasoning? You just wanted to come chill with the boys.
Yeah, I just wanted to get out. I mean, we normally film early, and you just wanted to sleep in or something, didn't you? So I thought, you know, I'll turn up nice and early. What are we doing today anyway? Should we dive into the topic?
Let's deep dive straight into it. So those that have read the title, I don't know if we've titled it yet, but we gave Adam a job. Think of a podcast idea, Adam. So he spent all of, I don't know, 2 seconds?
Yeah, something like that.
And went top 10 music.
Well, I did. There was some what I wanted to do was top 10 albums, but Josh's love of music does not apparently extend to albums. So he said we'll do top 15 singles instead. But our favorite 10 songs, but I couldn't, I mean, even 15 is hard, but I found it hard to condense to 10. But the reason that I thought that would be a good idea is not simply because it was an easy idea, which took very little thought. It was also because a lot of people really enjoyed that favorite films one. I think not because of the films that we mentioned, just because of the massive disparity between what we both chose and the fact that I took the piss out of you liking Jackass.
Yeah, we'll continue that on today. Brian Lacey actually said that you and I are just completely incompatible. And to be fair, we are polar opposites, aren't we, in most things? So maybe that's why it works.
Yeah, maybe. They say opposites attract, don't they?
Well, do you want to start off, mate? Do you want to give us your first song? Like we said, we're doing...
Well, I was going to invite you to just get your full list out of the way because I thought it'd be like track 1 to 10 on the Venga Boys Greatest Hits. No, it's not that.
Well, I was going to do Machine Gun Kelly's albums and then just...
Don't get me started. Right, am I going to start then?
Yeah.
I think, just for context, George, our producer... is going to pump some of this in somehow, either in real time or in the edit. But of course, we're limited to how much we can, because we don't want to get copyright claimed, right? So you might get like 8-second nuggets of each song. And I will preface this as well by saying, these probably aren't my 15 favorite songs to totally trash the concepts of podcasts. I want to do the same as I did with the movies thing and get a little bit, because if I tell you my 15 favorite songs, most people won't even know what they are, right? So I've got things in here which maybe... I wanted it to be that people knew some of them at least.
Do you think this is quite an intimidating podcast though? Because like music's such a personal thing, isn't it? Like not many people would hand over their Spotify account and just be like, oh yeah, go play some tracks and then look at what you previously listened to, like Carly Rae Jepsen or, you know, Justin Bieber. So it's quite a person, don't you think it's quite a personal thing to do?
Yeah, I get that sometimes. Like if I pick some up when I pick Kate Ovens up in the car, right? I was like, I think... Lindsay been in and we played something like N-dubs just for a laugh.
Yeah, yeah.
I thought, fuck, I need to search some new songs. I can't have that popping up on your recently listened to.
Oh, your Tesla with your big screen. It's like, it's just there.
See, because you open the Spotify app and it'll be like, last played. I'm like, fuck it, get rid of N-dubs.
S Club 7.
Let's not get started on S Club 7, shall we? Right, so I'm doing track number one.
Yeah.
Right, so this is, they're not really in ascending order, but I've kind of tried to arrange them in that way. So the first one is a track called The Artist in the Ambulance by a band called Thrice from 2003, which hardcore was like screamy punk for the uninitiated. And then post-hardcore was when that kind of, they started to introduce melodic elements to that, right? To make it a little bit more contemporary, shall we say. And that album, that probably would have been one of my top 10 albums if we had done that, just because it was so influential. But the song Artist in the Ambulance, which I don't know, I'm kind of waiting for, I don't know when George is going to play it.
Yeah, play it now.
That's George using one of his DJ tricks there. Little fade out. I thought it was going to be like a harsh cut. So what did you think of that, Josh?
Mate, I like it. I'd listened to that. I'd not heard that song before.
Yeah.
But I would definitely listen to that. That's...
yeah,
just it's pleasing to the ears.
Yeah? I thought it would be a little hard for you. That's probably one of the poppier numbers.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, like, Thrice lost me a little bit after that album because they got a little bit more experimental, right? I like that and probably the album before. But... The song is quite interesting. That apparently it was inspired by a real life. Obviously, you can tell by the lyrics, it's about a car crash, yeah. Right? And the artist in the ambulance, somebody being saved by a paramedic, right, after this car crash. Apparently, Dustin, I forget his surname, the lead singer from Thrice, they were in a car crash, right? Unfortunately, they survived. But I think that's what inspired it. I'm sure I read something that was like what inspired him to think of, shit, you know, what if I'd come a cropper of this drunk driver or some shit, like smashing at the back of me. And he wrote the song Artist in the Ambulance, which is it's literally about somebody being saved by a paramedic, right? But it's also got, I think, an interesting juxtaposition of, like, it's talking about the idea of you got these people in life, like, you know, your nurses, doctors, firemen, that save lives. And then you've got artists like him who are meant to create some meaning within life, right? And so I think there's something interesting in the song about that. But it's just, I think it's a cool song, and they were really... I think influential band, a lot of bands that came after, probably like your mate Machine Gun Kelly and Bring Me the Horizon, which George probably likes because he's young. They probably wouldn't have happened had it not been for Thrice. Have I besmirched you with that, George?
Bring Me the Horizon's not for me, man.
Oh, okay, well, they inspired a lot of bands that came thereafter, I think, and that song is... I mean, that whole album's good, but that song is...
When was that released?
2003, I think.
Oh, right, okay.
Early 2000s.
I like it, mate. Like, it wasn't as... I expected it to be much harder with your style of...
I didn't want to... I mean, I could have put some bombastic stuff in there,
yeah.
But I thought, like, I didn't want you to piss your pants. I know you're a little bit sensitive, but also I didn't want to...
Who the fuck was wrong with this guy?
I didn't want to, you know, put people off too early on. And I've got some curveballs in there as well.
Yeah?
So, yeah.
Sweet, man. Well, I've actually put my list in chronological order because I thought that'd be interesting. We'll go through the
earliest released to latest.
Yeah, from the earliest. From the latest to earliest, or, you know, basically as far in the far of a distance as we can to present day. That's what we're on.
In chronological order. Yeah. Okay.
Well, you seemed confused by that concept.
No, I'll be honest, I thought you were probably using the word chronological incorrectly. But that's my assumption.
I think I'm like educated in a shed. Do you know what I mean? Well, we managed to get here, didn't we?
Yeah. Anyway, sorry, go on. What's your number one? Your first one.
The first one. So yeah, definitely not my top. I don't know if it was hard. So we initially said, obviously, albums, then you said top 10. And I started writing 10 songs. You know, I tried to do a bit of research, trying to figure out which ones would
I put.
So
have you done 10?
I got like 15.
Oh, we said 15. Yeah, yeah. I thought we were going to be on even.
Yeah, no. But even then I was like, there's more I could have added. And then you start like nipping into different genres of music. I'm like, oh, wow. I do it in chronological order. It also made me really think about my life as like, you know, it's like, what have I listened to through the years, which was fucking mind blowing. But
so number one is Peter Andre, Mysterious Girl. Yeah.
Right. So the first song is, Pretty Fly for a White Guy by The Offspring, 1999.
Nice. 1999 was a good year. Don't you think, for culture, just in general? Yeah, like so many great movies came out that year, so much good music.
Not for festivals.
Woodstock 99.
That's crazy, right?
What a time. I was only, in 99, I'll have been 8 years old. No, 7 years old.
I could technically have gone to that festival. I thought you were going to make an age joke then.
No. But George, you want to play that? No, it's kind of hard just to get along today. Our subject isn't cool. Yeah. You know what I love about like this era of music, or particularly this style anyways, the music videos. Do you know what I mean? This is what inspired what we did with the Chicken Wing song, you know.
Yeah, to a lesser degree. But yeah, I know what you mean though. Yeah, that kind of energy.
Yeah, that vibe of it. And then the super like fisheye wide lenses. And yeah, so yeah, that was my first on my list. Mate, I haven't got quite an articulate backstory as you
just
have.
Just like it. Just love it. Just I mean, it. I don't think you really need to say that much about Offspring songs. It's just, to me, it's party music. There's very, I think, with the exception of some songs, that they're not really... And this isn't a criticism. They're not writing like super highbrow, really deep, meaningful songs, are they? It comes from that kind of whole ilk of pop punk. But I think Offspring probably verge more on the whole punk side of it. But they've got, what I like about the Offspring is they've got, or Offspring, is that they've got like a, you can tell an Offspring song before the before Dexter starts even singing. Yeah. You know, the guitars are really kind of quite sharp and, yeah, it's just cool music. And I, that was cool because it kind of broke in, do you remember, to the mainstream.
Yeah.
Like people,
yeah,
people like that never heard Offspring before, yeah, which is, I think it's kind of nice in a way that, you know, when a band gets an underground band kind of, if you will, gets that kind of breakout, right? Because, yeah, you know it's going to earn them coin, which is important to bands like that, you know, that are constantly touring. And but yeah, it's good that people recognize what they do. But yeah, that's a good song.
All right, well, there we go then. That's number one on my list there. So on to you, sir.
Right, the next one, I think it's a song that people will know. I thought a lot of the songs on this list people maybe won't know. But the next on my list is a song called Hallelujah. But my version, it's not the original, it's actually a cover. Mine's a Hallelujah by Jeff Buckley, which is a cover of an old famous Leonard Cohen song.
Can we, before we play it, can we get a rendition? Because I want to bring the singing beard back. What do we call the segment?
Well, I was actually...
Beard Sings.
I was actually going to bring the guitar to do a bit of a deconstruction here, but I thought we wouldn't really have time. And you asked me to sing the Jeff Buckley one.
Yeah.
So like probably the best singer on this list. I have to go like false out. It's like... secret chord that David played and it pleased the Lord, but you don't really care for music, do you?
Oh, beautiful. Right, play it, George.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Yeah, that's enough. I think you went a little bit high on your rendition there.
He was keen to shut that one down, wasn't he?
Yeah,
I bet that's because George.
Everybody knows that song, though, don't
Yeah, they? George gigs that, so he's probably asked by a bunch of drunk people every weekend. Hey, can you play that song, mate? Recently butchered, of course. I say butchered. That's harsh, but I think a lot of people probably know it more from less from that version and the original Leonard Cohen version, and more for the somebody from X Factor did it, right?
Yeah, they did, I think.
Probably every year they do that song.
For Christmas,
it was,
yeah,
like a number one at one Christmas, that, yeah.
But I mean, I think, although it's not the original, that's one of those few times when somebody covers a song and it's considered then almost a definitive version, right?
Do you like listening to cover artists?
Not people that just do covers, really.
No, but like, I remember like maybe sort of, probably 10 years ago, like that Boyce Avenue and all those on the...
Yeah, yeah.
And there's a dude called Teddy Swims. I don't know if you've seen that guy.
Yeah, he's good.
Unbelievable. Like I've seen him obviously doing all sorts of covers on YouTube and Instagram, and he's touring as well. But I think it's really cool when you see artists that do cover songs in their versions, and then they've now like, I suppose it's not original, but like it's.
I think there's value for me. Like if you listen to a cover artist, if they do something different with the song, then yeah. Like if you listen to that compared to say like the Leonard Cohen version, which makes me sound really old because ask your mum and dad about. I mean, I'm not as old. I wasn't around when Leonard Cohen's writing songs really, but like he's an old songwriter, right? But I don't think it's unfair of me to say he's probably not the greatest singer of all time, right? Wrote boss songs, but he wasn't the greatest singer. So like a lot of people would listen to the old one and be like, oh, this is a bit weird.
Yeah.
Whereas then you put Jeff Buckley into the mix, who's like an amazingly talented musician, died at 30. So a lot of people, you know, like rock stars and whatnot, die, you know, drugs overdose and
like
whatnot.
Like 27, wasn't it? 27 club.
Yeah, that was the age. But he died swimming, I think. I think he went for a dip. I don't know if he was just, I don't know. But that's kind of sad. But he did that and that was a song from his album Grace, which I think was released in the 90s. But it's always on, you know, TV shows and movies and whatnot. And I just think it's the song itself is cool because it's kind of a story about lost love and whatnot, but framed in like biblical language. So it's kind of interesting it's not like wet ass pussy, you know, we're talking about like a proper songwriter. So like it's cool to listen to.
There's another one of those songs on the radio now we sound really old now.
I don't give a shit, Minaj.
And half of the song's like muted out.
Anyway, yes, but so it's a cool song. Go listen to it if you haven't heard. You must have heard it already. But that version of it, if you listen to the full track, it's got a really cool build. It's like a really ethereal, you know, like it sounds like almost some kind of bolt from the gods. But it's a cool song, and I thought it'd be one that people know. So
and you dig it,
yeah.
All right. So the second one on my list, we're gonna stay in that realm of and genre that we just added before, which, like I said, we're like pop punk. Ish. Next one for me is Butterfly Crazy Town.
It was a tune that actually threw me.
That was the
last thing I expected. 1999,
what a banger. Play it, George.
Come, my lady, come, my lady. You're my butterfly, sugar.
Go on, what are you saying?
No, it made me laugh because I totally forgot that. You know when you get a song that you completely forget it exists and you're like, ah, that's a bit of a jam. Am I right in saying that the lead singer from that band was called Shifty Shellshock? Google that. I think he was called Shifty. Obviously, his mum did not christen him that. Or you would hope not.
You know that Shifty Shellshock, yeah. Wow.
You know that bass and guitar part as well? It's a Red Hot Chili Peppers sample, is that?
Oh, yeah.
So is it?
That just makes sense, yeah. Actually. Yeah,
it
yeah.
sounds a lot like John Frusciante. Is he the guitarist from... Yeah. I don't know what there's to say about that. It's clearly about sex, is it not? But it's a jam. I think it had a very unique sound sonically. But yeah, why do you like that song? Is that your is that the song you seduced your current wife to?
Absolutely not. But I've actually also, as we go down this list, we'll see us like dive into different genres of music, and there are some that's more sentimental, got some more sentimental value than just sort of
bit of Boys to Men in there, yeah.
Not quite. No. But so that's that one, mate. Do you want to go to your next one?
Yeah, yeah.
Before you do, you know that song, That Butterfly?
My
first like dip of the toe into YouTube when I was probably 7 or 8, I did a drum cover of that song.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, yeah.
When you were 8?
Yeah.
George is a fucking
beast.
He's
talented, right? Yeah. He's carrying us over, yeah.
I hope you're going to keep this in
there. Might still be on Facebook somewhere, actually.
Mate, right, this is staying in the podcast. I want to see this. Like, I want to see you drumming that. Like, get it cut in. You're talented, yeah. You, mate.
Did that come out when you were 8? Is that why? Was it new when you did that?
No, it was probably...
When were you born?
Probably been out a few years by that point.
When
did that come out?
99?
Yeah, yeah.
Is all your songs from 1999?
No, I'm going chronological out. So
I know, but the first one was 99, wasn't it?
Yes, I've done like a couple of 99, 2000, then worked my way through.
This could be a nightmare for you to cut together, Josh. That would have been a better way to do it. Maybe like best songs from a certain year. But anyway, we've done it now. Right, am I doing the next one now?
Mm-hmm.
Right. Next one, a song I would imagine everyone should know. It's Fast Car by Tracy Chapman. Maybe we make a deal. If you know it, Josh, we could just like stop it early.
Yeah, stop it now. Yeah.
I love how George is doing the really slow fade to stop thing. I was going to bring the guitar specifically to give you a little bit of flavour behind these, but I didn't think we'd have long enough to, you know, fully dissect the song. But
we should have done that, shouldn't we? Oh, well.
Maybe we could do it next time. Tracy Chapman, Fast Car. It's a little kind of softer, I guess, in nature than what I normally listen to, but I think Tracy Chapman's like, I don't want to say criminally underrated because most musicians think, no, she's amazing, but I mean, that's like a hallmark song, right?
Yeah, it's a classic, isn't it? And again, that's one of those where you hear it a lot by the big, like by the cover artists, you know. Like,
oh, God, have you heard that dance version they do of it? There's somebody's done like a dance kind of pop version. It makes me want to cry. And I'm like, you can't do that to a song like that. You know, I think there should be a law against it, but you can't like record labels own. I mean, that's why I can butcher songs every Christmas, you know, cause like anyone can do it really. You can get sued thereafter, but you can't stop somebody from covering something. But yeah, it's a song that it gained a lot of notoriety, I think, cause she did the Nelson Mandela 70th birthday thing, like the anti-apartheid in South Africa concert, which I think was in the late 80s, when she was like in her early 20s, in front of tons of people, you know, like I think that was like a first album, which was like a self-titled album. But I just think that song is like, for someone in their early 20s to write that song is, to me, unreal. Like the guitar hook, it seems so obvious, and it's quite simple, but it's got, you know, instantly know it, you know, and it's a song about, you know, a kid that's born in, a broken home, which you can tell by the lyrics. She's like, my mama went off and left him. She's talking about her dad.
Yeah.
She wanted more from life than he could give. Somebody's got to take care of him. So I quit school. That's what I did. And you can kind of, it's so vivid, you know, you can picture the story of, you get the feeling that part of it's autobiographical to some degree, or she's talking about, you know, somebody that's had a bad life and dreams of more, I guess. And, you know, the chorus comes to a crescendo, is talking about just driving in a fast car, but I think that's like a, you know, obtaining that freedom. I think it's just a real, like, I'm always impressed by people that are incredibly young that write songs that are so, complex in ideas and stuff. So yeah, I just think that's an amazing, just a good song.
Yeah, I think it's probably renowned for being, it's fucking legendary. It goes down in history, doesn't it? Again, like that's one of those songs that you hear in the street from like buskers, you know, so like up and coming talent, they'll sing, obviously it's recognizable for many people. So yeah, like I love seeing that where it's been like buskers are playing it in the street or even the cover. I really enjoy certain covers of it as well. Like, do you know Passenger? Have you? Do you know the?
Yeah, but no, you can't. The song. I think there are some songs you can't cover, and I think that would be one of them for me.
That's it. It's gatekeeping.
If you're a busker, you can't obviously like performing it. I mean,
yeah.
But I think it's a bit like following. We were talking about somebody following Heath Ledger as Joker.
Yeah,
it's a bit like it's a poison chalice. You can't make it any better. So why?
Do you gig that song ever, George?
No.
No.
You refuse. No.
I think it's a bit over-covered, to be honest. Yeah. That's why I kind of don't really do it.
Fair cop, all right. So
we're not asking George to do Fast Car at my wedding with Mrs. Beard.
I still want to see George play. Like, I'm yet to see it.
We really should go one of his gigs. I feel like every week, I was gigging here, and I'm like, oh, shit, maybe we should get a ticket.
First dancing garlic bread, I'm not coming.
Right, so the next song for me is, I've just swapped him around on your list.
Just listen to you.
All right, okay. So the next song on my list, so we're in the year 2000 now, In the End by Linkin Park.
Oh yeah, that's a saucy tune. Yeah, it's a good one.
I kept everything inside. I thought you know the song. Yeah, I tried it all
fell apart. George was just jamming to that, man. He left that on way longer than my last one.
Let's get the chorus.
Fire it in if you want.
I think the best part's the lead up to that song.
Yeah,
the chorus is just like a typical Linkin Park. You play like a detuned power chord and let it ring out forever.
But yeah, Linkin Park, they've got some bangers, aren't they? They've got that, they've got Gnome. Just a big fan.
You know, I think it's an interesting question. Do you think Gnome, just the song Gnome is better than the one they did Gnome, when they did the Jay-Z Encore, mixed like, kind of like the hybrid of it? Which do you think is better? I think that's one time when there are a few ones on the album that are all right, but like when they mixed in Encore, I thought it just made it like I bet Mike, is it Mike Shinoda? I bet he felt like a fucking plum, didn't he? All right, Mike, we're going to get a proper rapper in now.
Yeah, that's that.
So in the end, what was it you like about that?
No, for me, it was just one of those that, it was popular, but it just stands out as something a little bit different to the norm.
From their normal oeuvre, I guess, because I really like it in the end. That album, I remember buying that and it was like, I didn't really like that, you know, nu metal.
Yeah,
like a lot of that I don't really enjoy, and that, I think I remember buying Linkin Park. Was it a Hybrid Theory? The name of the first album? I think it was. I know it was. I don't know why. It was a rhetorical question.
Was it that or was it Meteora, which was the first?
Hybrid Theory was first, I think. I'm pretty sure because that was what we were gonna call the band at first, apparently, because you know, because it was like mashing up like rapping and scratching and all that shit. But yeah, in the end, it's a great song. R.I.P. Chester Bennington as well. Amazing singer. It's a song called Escape Artists Never Die by Funeral for a Friend.
Still not that heavy. Still not as heavy as
I could have gone heavy. I
behaved yourself today.
I was worried about your sensibilities, you know. I thought even that one would melt your face off, but it didn't, no?
No, I approve.
You'd never heard it before, though?
No.
Yeah, I remember, Funeral for a Friend are they were kind of like a time, you know, in the early to late 2000s and stuff when there were lots of American bands doing music that sounded like this, and they're Welsh. So I think like a lot of, certainly British people, British kids like me at the time, say kids, I was at uni when I remember buying this, actually. I remember buying it from, you remember Virgin Records? I don't know why I'm looking at George.
Yeah, yeah.
That under, I don't know what the fuck it is now. The artwork is like it's a couple like sat with their backs to each other with what looks like a plastic shopping bag over their heads. It's not that, it's just some fabric. But yeah, I remember buying that and just being like blown away by it and thinking, oh, I'm finally like a British band, which is making music that I like. And I think it was like really, I think that paved the way for a lot of similar English bands that came, or British bands, sorry, because they're Welsh, that came after. But yeah, it's a song about, I think it's quite literally about an escape artist dying. And it's framed in that whole kind of emo universe of like, you know, there's probably some allegorical meaning behind it, but the lyrics are that he's drowning in this tank. And you know, like, I don't know if he's, at the end it says, please someone help me. So maybe it's just quite literally about a poor geezer dying in one of those escape artist water acts. But yeah, it's just, I love Funeral for a Friend. I'd love to get, they were playing in Leeds, I think a couple of weeks ago. And I thought, hey, maybe I could drop Matt Davies or one of the other guys like a message, but I just don't think they come on. And nobody would know him anyway, so they'd be like, well, you know, what's the point of this guy coming on?
Judging by his track record of trying to get guests on, I agree.
I think would have failed.
I don't think we would have got him on.
It's Leeds Festival this weekend, isn't it?
Oh, is it?
So I did think there'd be a bunch of people in Leeds, but then I thought like none of them would come on. So like, what's the fucking point?
It's not an artist, but I saw a comment on YouTube, somebody saying about getting Tom Stoltman on. Whoever commented
that. Yeah, we've tried.
You know, it turns out you can lift weights, but you can't send emails. That man was fucking painful to talk to. Like, I've got a long, long back and forth with that human.
It's all right, mate. If people don't want to come on, it's fine. I'm not going to hold it against
him. No, he said he wants to come on. It's just they were just impossible to communicate with.
That's the bug to me. Like, if you don't want to come on, say no. And I'll be like, yeah, sweet, mate. I don't expect you to. We messaged a couple of people. In fact, one person who was in a band on this list, actually. I messaged and he was very polite.
But
he had good reasons to.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think he replied, he said, if you're ever a gig, give me a shout, I'll buy you a beer. So I thought, that's nice of him. I mean, I'm sure it was like an empty offer, but it was nice of him to say.
Right, it's my go now.
Yeah.
Right, Adam, this is where it's about to go south for you, mate.
Cheeky
backstory,
girls, yeah.
Backstory, right? So this is not a good song. But however, this is... From my recollection, I ain't got a good memory, but this is the first single I ever bought. So I bought it from Woolworths for like £1.99 or whatever it was. I got my pocket money.
You get a bit of a pass for that if it's the first single in the year
2000.
Don't tell me it's Busted.
Jesus. Oh, shit, I didn't even put Busted on there, but Busted would have been like second. Who Let the Dogs Out by the Baha Men. Oh, play it, George.
Who let the dogs out?
Thank you, George. You came in with the cut over.
That is
there.
A true story.
I mean, there's a limited degree to which I can judge you for that. How old were you?
I've been eight.
Eight.
Nine, yeah.
So I can't really judge you for that, can I? But no, I don't think I ever understood that song. It reminds me of that scene from The Hangover, you know, where Alan says, hey guys, you ready to let the dogs out? And then Bradley Cooper's like, what? He's like, yeah, who let the dogs out? Who let the dogs out? You know, it reminds me of that. But fucking terrible song. Yeah. Next. Why do you even like that? Just because it was the first one that you bought?
They were just like, I just recall having that CD and that was, I remember being the first CD that I bought.
Remember those kids? CDs?
But Busted, what a fucking shout. I am, but Busted on the list. I used to be a fan of Busted. I did.
Fucking hell.
George, you would have been too young for that, weren't you? Busted, are you?
No, I think I was in primary when... They were sort of
we'll have both been at school, like, so yeah. I think that's probably why we're more inclined for it. But you go to your next one, mate.
Well, I think I might get a bit of grief for my next one, certainly from George, and actually a lot of the people listening, I think, because they are a band that's a little bit like Marmite. She's American by 1975.
Why don't you like them, George?
Oh, I just think the gimps me.
Run it.
Don't say that, man, because I'd love to get like George Daniel on, who's the fucking drummer, not Mike Healy.
I don't know, what can you not like about that?
I don't mind the music.
He's one
I
of
just
those.
Don't like the he's one of those personality gatekeepers. Of the band. Like, it just annoy me.
Oh, right.
It's mainly Matt Healy. I don't really have anything against the rest of them. I don't know the rest of them.
I don't think he'd be listening, George. I think yeah, so I'm going to spend a little, not too long, but a lot of people hate 1975. They're kind of like Marmite. A lot, like all my friends are constantly, because we're all into pretty much like punk and rock and metal and stuff like that. I'm always getting grief for it, you know. But I think they're criminally underrated. I think they're one of those bands, right? Especially when you get caught up in genres and whatnot. It's like I heard they're replacing Rage Against the Machine, right, at Leeds Festival, and people were raging about it all over Twitter. I get it, because they're not the same genre, right? But a lot of people that are into alternative music hate them because it's pop music, essentially. Yeah. It's not rock music. But I think there's something to be said for good pop bands, right? If there's nothing wrong with pop music. If you write it, the only thing I resent about pop music is that people typically don't write their own songs these days, or if they do, they're really shit songs. So a band like 1975 would just write good pop tunes mostly, but with very complex lyrics, and the instrumentation is really good, even though it just sounds kind of saccharine and like it's a, you know, the default audience, a target audience, I guess, not target, but like if you go to 1975 gig, it's mostly teenage girls a lot of the time. Not there's anything wrong with that, but that, you, people, I think, look at them a bit like a boy band, right? And that's why I hate them. But I think they're a super underrated band. The Cheese Americans, like, it's like them, I guess, at their indulgent best. You know, if you listen to the from a musicology perspective, it's not simple. It's got like this kind of funky guitar groove. They're not playing power chords, you know, progressively over 3 minutes. It sounds like it could be a Michael Jackson song almost. You know what I mean? It's got that kind of old 80s vibe to it, and that's intentional. And but the lyrics are, because I think he's quite a smart kid despite being a smackhead, you know. Can I say that?
Well, is he like quite literally a smackhead?
Yeah, he confessed he was addicted to heroin, wow. Which is like, it's not exactly a that's, you know, an amateur's drug.
That's top shelf, that, isn't it?
Yeah, quite literally. But but he's a smart kid, you know, and like a lot of the lyrics he writes are really clever, I think. So I'll probably get a bunch. I'd love to see, leave it in the comments what you think about 1975 and the fact that I like him. Lynn's actually got me into him.
I was going to say, has it come from Mrs. Beard?
Yeah, because they lost me a bit at the last album. That was kind of way too trippy and, you know, a little bit, I don't want to say pretentious, because a musician can do what they want. It's a bit like creating anything, really. You don't want to be doing the same shit forever. But I didn't like it as much. The first album I knew of, the one with like Chocolate On and Sex, which are cool songs, but it was a bit like just kind of straight indie pop, really. And then Lynn was playing that, the second album, which this one is from. I Like It When You Sleep. It's a really long title. I Like It When You Sleep Something, right?
Yeah.
Which I think was like, I don't know, 2016 maybe? And I remember just listening to it and being like, at first, it kind of ground me down at first. I was like, what the fuck's this shit? And then...
can you imagine living with him?
After a while, I was like... prick. After a while, I was like, this has got really good songs on. There's a ton of great songs on the album, you know? But I think people like music are reluctant to listen to it because it's kind of, it's pop music, you know?
I put it on in the studio the other day, didn't I? I put 1975 radio on, and you could hear the sigh from George behind his computer.
Was he sighing or orgasming? That sounded like he was coming to climax.
Was that your climax? Right, so we move on then?
Yeah.
All right, so the next one. I think mine's going to just end up being like a millennial soundtrack, to be honest. I think
this is just pop punk hits.
Yeah.
I should have said, by the way, that in case, because I said what every song was about, right? That song's good as well, because it's about like the disparity between American and English culture. You know, because the song's called She's American.
Yeah.
And there's a lyric in it that says, if she says, I've got to fix my teeth, then she's so American. And it's talking about like the difference between, you know, it talks about gun ownership as well in a kind of oblique, metaphorical way. But yeah, anyway, sorry. I had to tell you what the song was about, because like I've done that on every other song.
Yeah.
Sorry, go on.
Smart fella, George, you're a fast smeller.
Macarena, yeah?
Next up is, for me, the year 2000. We're still in the... I've only advanced into 2 years
so far.
You keep
saying that. Isn't that the
song?
Yeah, I thought it was the title of a busted song. But
that's the year.
As long as that's not in there. Go on. So we're in 2000.
3000.
Oh, whatever. We've gone from 99 to 2000.
This is Miss Jackson by Outkast.
That's a great song.
I don't really have much to say about it other than that it's fucking classic, isn't it? Do you know?
I love the way you deconstruct all these songs.
I'm not as articulate or as well educated in music as both you guys are. So it's quite intimidating to be sat here and attempting to
But you can say
opinion on music.
To be fair, it works to say it's classic. It is. I think what I liked about that song, because I'm not really like into hip hop, really. There's some hip hop songs I like. But like if I was going to listen to any hip hop artist, it'd probably be Outkast, because it seems to me that to be a little bit more, they're not rapping about like, you know, shooting hookers and I don't know, like robbing banks, are they? You know, that's the song about him not liking his mother-in-law, isn't it?
Yeah, but the storytelling out there, you've got Andre 3000 and then the...
Big Boy, Fat Boy.
Yeah, Big Boy, yeah.
Yeah, I was right. Yeah, and you're right. He's telling a story. I think that song's got a really kind of dark feel to it. You know, a lot of hip hop songs, I think they follow us. Either they'll use a sample or they follow some kind of. There's not a great deal of melodic. Sometimes there is, but there's not a great deal of melodic value there. But that's got that whole kind of trippy. It sounds like it's recorded on some lo-fi device when it comes in, and you know. But yeah, I think it's a great song. I mean, it was all over the radio. I remember it being over the radio, you know, when people used to listen to the radio.
What's the other song that were very popular about Outkast?
Fresh and Clean, is that one? Fresh and So Clean. Ain't nobody, don't ask me, I hey, dress up.
Pardon?
Oh, yeah, hey, yeah.
Hey, yeah, that, yeah.
I once saw, like,
I have expected him to break out into Beard Sings there.
No, well, I did sing for a bit.
Go on.
No, I'm not going to do that part. Oh, okay. I went to a gig in London, and a band, punk band that you certainly won't know called Pennywise did a cover of that. It was fucking ace. They were like, everyone here says we're not punk. We're not punk anymore. This is punk. And then they proceeded to cover a pop song. but it was ace, yeah. I think it was at like, was it Brixton Academy maybe? I don't know, but that was cool. Memories.
Memories. Your turn.
Am I next? It's going to take us fucking forever.
This is fun, this though. Isn't this fucking good?
It is fun. The next one I almost didn't want to put it on the list, but it was such a gateway song for me that got me into good music. All the Small Things, Blink 182. That might be on your, is it on your list?
No, but I've got a track from Enema of the State. So yeah. Roll it, George. All the
small things. George smells. George stinks. I used to jam with like a little, you know, group of mates.
Maybe we can play it with our, as
you
a band.
You need to get this idea out of your head, man, I'm telling you.
I can't wait for this to start a band.
I spent about fucking, you did take to the bass, I mean, bass is easy to learn, but you took to it quite well. We'll get onto that at a future date. But yeah, I picked this primarily, I mean, it's a great song, but I picked it because it was kind of a gateway song to me, whereby, I mean, I didn't really like, I wasn't really super into music until this point. And I remember seeing it on, there was the show that used to be on, I think Channel 4, really early on Saturday mornings. I think it was called like a chart show or something, but they would play all the videos from songs, but like it was from like 40 up. So you'd get a lot of songs that you didn't really hear on the radio. I remember hearing it, seeing the video, and it sounds like Tom DeLonge doing the vocals on that. They've got such a, like, they can't sing, right? I mean, that's probably harsh to say because they're musicians, but they're not the most gifted vocalists, right? But they've got like a real, they've got that SoCal pop punk vibe to their voice. So I think it's inspired a lot by bands like NOFX. But in Enema of the State was really polished, right? It was the first big production after Dude Ranch, the album before. And I remember thinking, this is like off the wall, like your shirt. The videos, you know, they were just taking the piss out of the Backstreet Boys. And I was like, fuck yeah, this is finally something that like I can get into. And it was because I remember buying that album. And I remember just after, that was the line for me. Like before that, I wasn't not into music, but like, I was like, right, this is it for me. You know, this is music that I love. And I think the story behind that's interesting as well. Like it almost, the studio said to him, like, we'll put like the X budget into this album, but we need a breakout single from it. And they apparently didn't like What's My Age Again, which was the second single, enough to say it was like a strong one.
Yeah.
So they specifically wrote All the Small Things as a single. And you can tell because it's such a simple song. It's like, it's literally like three chords, I think, the song.
It's very nursery rhyme and it's melodies and stuff in it.
It's quite literally good. Na 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 na. But I just think it's a cool song, and the video for it again is, I think it's legendary, isn't it?
Yeah, it's legendary.
The whole like Travis, I'm pregnant, and the fact that like there's Mark getting you think he's in a waterfall and he's being hosed off by the guy who's cleaning the tour bus kind of thing. I think, and that album was unreal. So yeah,
I like it, mate. I like it. Like, as I said, one of them songs comes up on my list as well. Next up for me then. All right, so we've gone from like your Linkin Parks to, you know, your Crazy Town. We've gone to a little bit of Outkast. Now, so we're in 2002, right? So you've had the Marshall Mathers LP, then you've got the Eminem Show. So I've put Sing for the Moment down. Like, personally, the Eminem Show album is unbelievable, but I just thought Sing for the Moment, again, it's one of those, it's a bit different, tells a good story. Run it, George. I don't know. I think it's one of them tracks where, like, when you're a teenager, you can listen to it and it's like real, innit? As you listen to it, you go, you can relate to that a little bit. You know?
Walking down the street on a bleak day in Morley, fuck the world.
Yeah. So I just, but yeah, I just thought that the whole album for me were class, though. You know, the Eminem Show, I thought it were great. It's a shame that like his more recent stuff isn't as popping. Do you know what I mean? Maybe it's like maybe he'll have his comeuppance again.
I don't know. I think there's a shelf life to anything you do. Yeah. I think there are very few artists that are going to make things that one person likes for the majority of their career. To me, because there's going to be so much, only so much you can say. You get that with so many bands.
Yeah.
Every band that I think has three or four albums that are good or that appeal to you, and then after that you might lose it. And that happens with a lot of bands for me. But I think he's a fucking genius. Eminem. I think, like I said, I'm not really into hip-hop and rap and stuff. But, like, lyrically, he's just a level above, isn't he? Like,
yeah.
Really. And I think his story, like, even if you watch the movie 8 Mile, you know, like, it's an interesting film. And, like, I think his story is quite inspiring in a way. And I like the fact that his songs aren't, they're not like your typical rap songs, you know. There's something there that's a bit of substance behind it.
And he's like, I'm not a musician, but the way that he raps and he's like, his cadence, I guess, is very different to what you would normally hear. Is that correct? Is that right?
He said that in an interview somewhere.
Yeah.
Is that correct?
Or me saying
is that correct?
Yeah.
I mean, I know pacing from obviously making videos and understanding sort of beats in that sense. But yeah, like, just
he's got an interesting way of unusual, of using rhythm, I think, in his vocal. Yeah, are we ready for? So yeah, I'm pretty impressed. It's not, you know, perfectly in line with what I like, but I can respect all the stuff you've picked here. Went to me next.
Yeah, man.
Right. Well, I was originally gonna say "Stand by Me" by Ben E. King, but hold your horses, George, because I changed my mind, because that's a bit of a sad song for me now, because my dad used to sing it to me when I was a kid, and we'd go for like a little walk around the field near our house. He'd have me on his shoulders.
Oh, right. I wonder what you were doing there.
Yeah, is that how you walk with a kid on your shoulders? Probably shouldn't do that these days, right? Health and safety. But like, walking his shoulders, he'd be singing.
Were your dad as small as you? Can you imagine? He's a normal size human.
You can't put a kid on your shoulders, but you can put a whatever month old on a bike.
Yeah, you can put a 1.5-year-old on a bike. I bet they even have stabilizers on it.
There wasn't.
So that is a good song, but I think it's quite predictable, right? Benny King, Stand By Me. So I guess we'll call that a bonus song. So I'm going to throw into the mix, George, if you can find it. This has come out of left field, right? A song by a band called Alpha Beat called The Spell. If you can find that, we're going to have a little disco tech in this house.
We can just make our own memes now. Fuck me. Get that cow.
That's the intro right there.
Whatever, man. Yeah, like, whatever floats your boat. I can't really get behind that. Whatever that was.
In truth, that probably would not make my top 15 songs. You know, if I was to go to Desert Island, I wouldn't be taking that one with me. But it's different.
It shows you've got a very eclectic taste in music, which is nice.
Yeah, a lot of people will know that Alpha Beat, they are a Danish pop band, right? But again, they write their own songs, which is, I've got a lot of respect for that. But a lot of people know them from the song Fascination.
That's what I'm thinking of.
But that was the second album. I think they got dropped off the record label.
I think I remember listening to them play that. Do you remember Party in the Park? In Leeds?
No, because it was a fake festival, so I never went. But like, I remember it existing, yeah.
It was free. Like, I think Radio Leeds put it on. And
yeah, you just got a bunch of chavs there, didn't you? Yeah. Because it wasn't like, yeah, it was just like shit music. But
you've just fucking played one of their tracks.
Yeah, well, you can't criticize the bands for playing it. But yeah, I thought that'd be out of left field. It might get people laughing at me and commenting below. But I love that song. Like, even Lynn's, she doesn't have a terrible taste in music, but it's pretty bad. Well, like, if I put that in the car, we're on the way back from a food challenge, I'm just, you know, a bit high on sugar and carbs and whatnot, I should be like...
Any more words on the Alpha Beat?
No, I just want to see what people... Get down in the comments and give me a razzing.
Man, this is a fun... This is up there, my favourite podcast.
Yeah, well, just leave it to me.
This is a fucking fun podcast.
Leave it to me. I'll drag us through the minefield of shit podcasts.
So I think I've got 16 songs now, because I just added one because of what you said before, but we're now in the year 2003.
Just hit the 2-hour mark, by the way.
How long have we been running?
An hour.
Right. So we're in 2003. This, for me, was like... I fucking loved Busted back in the day, so Crash the Wedding by Busted.
Oh, you can't be adding... Oh, my God.
Sorry that it's on a wedding day. Classic. Fucking classic. Busted. The Beatles. Justin Bieber. They're all up there. I fucking love Busted.
No.
Yeah?
No.
George?
Didn't they get together with McFly and do Muckbusted?
Oh, yeah, can we just stop? Like, what? As if it wasn't bad enough already?
Fucking combination, that is.
It was all, like, masquerading as pop punk, it was all just like contrived, like, you know, they've got a bunch of fucking fools together
it's just pop punk but without the punk, basically.
I hated that, like, they were pretending to play instruments. I mean I'm sure I know they can, because I don't want to give them too much of a hard time. Do what you like, especially when you're young. Like, if a label says, hey, get together, we're gonna form this band, do what you want. Because he went on to do that Fight Star, didn't he, the main guy. Band called Fight Star, who I don't think, I mean, I didn't like him, but at least he could play, I guess. But yeah, no, I'm not with you there. Okay. Sorry.
Well, that's fine. I accept that. Next.
Next for me is a song called What Sarah Said by a band called Death Cab for Cutie.
Like it?
Yes, a song by one of my favourite bands. They kind of lost me a little bit, like most bands do, after Plans, which I think was their fifth album. But yeah, I used to listen to them a lot when I was in my like, mid-20s. And that was after their big breakout album, Transatlanticism. That was on Plans, I think, which I think was like maybe 2004 or 5. Don't know, but it's about someone dying, basically, which you can get from the lyrics because he's in a hospital. And right. I think the thing about Death Cab that I like is that he's Ben Gibbons, that he's got like a really quite distinct voice. And they're kind of like on that weird edge between it's not really indie music. It's not really like emo or, you know, or pop. It's kind of like somewhere in the middle, right? Which makes it a lot of it's like melancholic, and it's really emotive music to just listen to, especially with that, because they're not really a piano band really, but that leads with like a piano hook, right? And yeah, I just think they're one of those bands that if a lot of people that are into music, I think, listen to them when they get past that kind of Blink-182 stage. Yeah. If that makes sense.
Yeah.
Not that's a criticism, but yeah, that's a song about someone dying, you know. And
kind of reminds me of The Fray, about How to Save a Life.
You fucking, how dare you? It's not even the same thing.
It does though, it sounds pretty similar.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, A, that was before, I think.
Okay. And,
but so no,
How to Save a Life sounds like this.
To be fair, I don't really.
You know, weirdly, that's when you say that song to me, you know what it reminds me of? Scrubs. I don't know why, but you know, remember playing Gears of War on Xbox? I think it came out at the exact same time. Do you remember that?
Were you playing Gears of War, like shooting those alien things, like while you listen to The Fray?
Yeah, yeah.
Or was that getting you? That was the height of that's how heavy you go.
Remember you pressed like get the square on, and you could cut the fucking zombie's head off.
Chainsaw him in the face.
Yeah. Do you remember?
While The Fray plays.
Yeah.
How to take
off. I don't know why. It must be the same time in like. Hey, yeah, I don't know. No, that's just, I'm just speaking out loud.
Yeah, it's just a good song. Lots of, it's a sad song. Not exactly when you're going to jive too, but yeah.
All right, next song for me. So we're in the year 2005 now, arguably one of the most popular songs of the year by one of the greatest bands to ever walk this planet. This band I could listen to their album.
Why am I so apprehensive about what
this
is going to be?
This band, their albums back to back to back to back. This is Photograph by Nickelback. And what the hell is
on Joey's head? Have you seen the meme where he's like, look at this graph? Look at this graph.
But yeah, I'm genuinely a big fan of Nickelback.
I got that because you were, we had a discussion on an earlier podcast where you were talking about music gatekeepers.
Yeah.
And you thought that George and I hated Nickelback for some reason, like everyone else seems to. I don't get that at all. I have a lot of respect for anyone that like they write their own songs. I think to me, I wouldn't listen to Nickelback by choice often because it's just kind of like straight rock music, which I'm not really that into. Yeah. Right? But I think Nickelback write good. It's interesting you choose that one. Rather than say like How You Remind Me or the Rockstar one, which I thought was a real cool song.
Yeah, the Rockstar, that Rockstar one. I mean, so that obviously they got people to sing that song. And I remember when I was joining, going to see, they'd done a like as part of like a PR thing. I think they'd done it on like, not quite from the Navy or anything like that, but they'd got people from different ranks across different ships across the fleet to sing like different, you know, made the Rockstar song. And I thought that's pretty cool, you know, which is in time because I joined in 2000.
It's good to see that the defense budget of the country is being spent appropriately.
It was done in-house. But yeah, man, Nickelback, I could actually pick some different songs off their albums, but then people wouldn't know what they are. I'm genuinely a fan. I went to watch them at Leeds Arena. You just farted. You just farted, didn't you?
I thought you hadn't noticed.
But yeah, I went to watch them at Leeds Arena. The only off-put one.
Another one's coming now. If you notice the first, it's kind of, I'm sorry.
When I went to watch them at Leeds Arena, they were getting right into it. Yeah. And what's the lead singer called?
Chad Kroeger.
Yeah, so
Kroeger, like he's related to Freddy Kroeger. Chad Kroeger.
Chad Kroeger. was like obviously playing along, and he's like, get your devil horns in the air. And I'm like, I'm not a devil horn sort of guy, man. Like, just fucking play the song.
Do you know the origins of the rock hand thing?
Yeah.
Apparently it was, you know, Gene Simmons from Kiss.
Yeah.
Used to hold his pick somewhat unorthodoxly like that. And he would go like that to the crowd while holding his pick, his plectrum.
Ah.
And so people would copy it in the crowd, and then it became this like universal signal for a symbol, even for being in the crowd. Be like, yeah, man.
That's sick.
Yeah.
Wonder how true it is. That could
total folklore, but I think that's, it sounds like it could be true.
I like it. We'll keep it. All right, mate. Next song for you.
I thought we were going to do more of a deconstruction of Nickelback then. Next one. Here we
no
go.
No one needs that.
Here we go.
George is on gatekeeper.
We could do a literal deconstruction of Nickelback. I physically take them apart. Next song is Dance Macabre by a band called Ghost. I used to think the song said, I just wanna be with you, but he was saying it, you know, like a bit of a gangster, like be with you, but he's saying bewitch.
Ah.
So yeah, Ghost, if you don't know, they won't be everyone's cup of tea, that's for sure. They're a band led by a dude called Tobias Forge. I think he is Swedish, maybe. But they dress up. It's all a theatrical thing. They're not like devil worshippers or anything. I don't think so. But he dresses up as kind of like a like an anti-pope style figure. So he dresses up in the kind of like cardinal outfits and stuff. With I'd love to see. I've never seen them live. They were in Leeds actually when I was out of the country not long ago. So yeah, one of the few bands probably on this. Well, not a few actually, because I've never seen Tracy Chapman live. Anyway, I'd like to see him live. But yeah, they're kind of just like a. I would describe them as kind of like a retro rock band. They've got they use like a lot of organs and stuff in some of their work, and they've got like, if you want to check them out, like listen to, I would say their standout songs, because they're one of those bands that I don't think they really write great albums. Like some of the stuff, I'll be like, I really don't like that. But then the bangers like this are really good. I think if I got some on my head.
What a difficult thing for an artist to do, to try and write a full album that's going to be pleasing to all, you know, like and how critical consumers are, as you well know, being a creator on the internet.
Mm. Yeah, it must be really hard. You see that a lot of time. I saw it with A Day to Remember, who did not make the list, sadly. Neither did AFI, so I wore another one of my favorite bands. I saw somebody comment on, I think, I don't know if they reshared it or something, or somebody had commented saying, this album is shit. Can't believe it took you like 2 years to make it. And I thought, do you have any idea how hard it is to make, like, especially an album whereby you're not just going in, oh, I've got these songs, boom, they write themselves. Yeah. Forget all like the engineering and recording work that goes into it and the writing. It's the shit you throw away and that you don't put on the album, you know? And especially when you've got a mix of say like four or five people, they've all got their different ideas. So I hate when I see that. Like if a new album comes out of a band that you like and you don't like it, then you just, don't like it, right?
Yeah.
I don't think there's any need to make an artist feel bad. That happens with every band because they don't want to keep making the same thing. As much as you might want to hear Blink-182 sing about boobies and shit in your pants and whatnot. They're not, they're 45 years old now, 50 years old, so they're not going to be singing about that. But yeah, I mean, I think Ghost are, I remember one person actually in my comments saying I've unsubscribed because you like Ghost. Because a lot of deeply religious people, I think take offense, but it's all theatrics. It's like when Sex Pistols said back in the, you know, the late 70s or whenever it was, I am an antichrist. I don't think he literally meant he is the antichrist. He's just doing it for effect, you know?
Yeah.
But the shows look really theatrical, and the songs are just like proper, they're really seated in that kind of classic rock anthem. It's almost like a Bon Jovi with like a slightly demonic twist. That's probably the best way to put it, I reckon.
Oh, yes,
class tune.
Yeah, I feel like I've heard that song before. I mean, when did that get released?
It was a recent 2018, I think. Or
oh,
17.
Really? Yeah, it seems like it feels like it's a song that I might have heard a long time ago. I don't know if it's got. But
to be fair, it could be like a Bon Jovi song, couldn't it? If
yeah,
it
I guess
it,
so.
In
yeah.
a way, but yeah, that's what I alluded to earlier as well. I probably shouldn't say actually, but the band Ghost. It's really just Tobias Forge, who's the front man. Then he has a bunch of session musicians, a bit like Slipknot. They're all dressed up in attire, so nobody really knows who they are. But it transpired that a musician who is not, he's from not far from here, who's been in a bunch of other bands, is actually one of these musicians in Ghost.
Oh, wow.
So I wanted to get him on to talk about it, but I think he's not really allowed to.
Oh, right.
So because I thought it would be kind of like a
cool. How did you find out then?
Because funnily enough, one of my good friends, he used to say, like, I've got a mate I've known since I was 10, right? And he's got some other mates. He's always going out to like live gigs. I'm a bit too old for that now. I can't face it anymore. I'm like fucking standing up for 2 hours now. but he goes to a lot of gigs and he's got some friends that are always, you know, at gigs and whatnot. And he would say to me whenever we were out drinking, he'd be like, I know the one of the guitarists from Ghost. And I'd be like, no, you fucking don't. Like, are you joking? Because I thought they would all be like Swedish, I guess, like yeah. Tobias Forge or like, because of how big Ghost are. They play stadiums, you know? And it turns out he was right. He knew the guy. He knew that one of the guys who played guitar in the band. But so I had to kind of go to him like cap in hand after like kind of apologize. Like, I'm sorry, mate. I just didn't think that you could possibly know.
Oh, wow.
One of the dudes from Ghost. But yeah, I think understandably, I don't think he's legally probably allowed to talk about it because they're supposed to be, you know, secret people reason. I don't know.
That's pretty cool. I like that. Yeah, I respect that. Yeah.
Small world, isn't it?
Yeah, very small world. Amazing. All right. Well, next one on my list then. I don't know how this one's going to land with you actually, Adam. So again, we're still in that millennial vibe. There are a bunch of songs that I wish I could have put on there as well, but...
this is going to be a long one, isn't it?
I know, yeah, sorry. This
should
is
have stuck to 10 maybe. My fault.
Gym Class Heroes, Cupid's Chokehold. Do you remember it?
Yeah.
Fucking classic, isn't it?
Yeah. Take a look at my girlfriend.
She's the only one I got. Pretty sure Travis McCoy, who's the dude that's rapping on that, is it was with Katy Perry for a while, so she's in the video.
So she's in the video.
Let's fact check that. Actually,
should you want me to give a little bit of commentary while you're doing
that? Yeah, do it. Yeah,
about,
yeah.
I mean, I know it's your song, but what song does it famously sample? Does anyone know?
No.
George, you're let off because we're all probably not that old enough to have been around. It's Supertramp, Breakfast in America. You know, that first part.
Yeah.
But I didn't mind that. I would say by any stretch of the imagination, I'm a Gym Class Heroes fan. But again, I can appreciate like any like hip hop act or like rap act or whatever you want to call it, where they're rapping about things that aren't, you know, stuff that Biggie and Tupac were rapping about.
Look, Katy Perry. Yeah, so they were together.
Yeah. Hmm. Nice. Sure, it would have been gossip like 20 years ago. But
In 2006, when it got released.
Is that what it was?
Yeah. How old do you feel now?
I remember that coming out, man. but yes, I think I have full respect for that, yeah. What was the other one they did, Cookie Jar? That was all right.
Yeah, Cookie Jar, yeah. Your song, mate.
I'm the one that's causing the hold-up here, aren't I?
Taking
too long.
You've got like the history behind all your songs. I do not have that.
Next one. Bit controversial because... turns out the lead singer of this band is a bit of a sex pest. I'm not getting at Lost Prophets before you say that. I don't even know if I can say sex pest, but it's a song called...
Beep out again.
Yeah. you're going to have to beep it now. The song is just so good that I'm saying it regardless. The Quiet Things That No One Ever Knows by a band called Brand New from their album Deja Intendu of... 2003. I was never like hugely into Brand New. I mean, I like Your Favorite Weapon and this album, Deja Intendu. And then after that, I saw they were one of the worst bands I've ever seen live. The dude, I think he was just smacked off his head. Like, he just came out and he was like, so I get that rock star life and everything, right? But I saw him at Leeds. I've actually seen them twice, and the second time they weren't as bad, but they still weren't great. But I just think this album is, Deja Intendu is just unreal, you know, especially because they were so young at the time. And The Quiet Things is, I don't know, there's something about it, it's hard to articulate, but it's the chord progression of it is like, it's pretty simple, you know, little riff at the beginning. I was going to bring the guitar in, I'll whip it out afterwards. That can be lesson number two for you. but it's such like a melancholy vibe to it. But it's a song about, I think, like a marriage, which has become humdrum, you know, and he's a bit bored. And I think he was like a serial, where he said it, I think there was a point recently where he said he was a sex addict and he was in rehab for it or something, the lead singer, Jesse Lacey. But this song is about him having an affair with another woman, I guess. Keeping it quiet, you know, quiet things that no one ever knows. And him recounting like his wedding day. It sounds like me actually. It says that, what does it say?
You're the opposite to a sex addict.
Yeah, you are. Right? He says, what, your veil was ruined in the rain. I contemplate the day we wed, your friends are boring me to death. That's something that would happen if like Lindsay and I got married, like a friend, yeah, be like, get the fuck away. I don't want to talk to you. But it's just an incredible song. And that whole, that I think the cool thing about Brand New was at the time, they were kind of one of those undergroundy bands that not many people knew. And then Deja and Tendu sent them into like a different level. And again, it's just a really, just for young guys, it's like a really complex, lyrically complex album. And yeah, it's tarnished only a little bit by the fact that the lead singer's, I don't know what to say legally. I think he was accused of something. I don't know if he was convicted. So probably best we either cut it entirely.
He was accused of trying to buy food off a little girl in an airplane.
No, I think he was accused of... I think he was accused of...
the bad stuff.
Sexual misconduct, let's put it that way.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah, it's just an amazing song. I love how gritty the vocals are as well, but melodic at the same time. A bit like Chester Bennington-esque. Not that I want to put him in that bracket of singer, but the two coming together makes that kind of sound. And yeah, just, I mean, don't see him live, just listen to the record.
All right, next song for me is... so you might remember this track from... Do you ever watch Shrek?
I know what it is already. I'm already searching it.
I mean, I've seen Shrek. I don't recall.
Yeah, so
really
in 2009, it was the anthem of Shrek. It was All Star by Smash Mouth.
Hey now, you're an all star. Get your game on, go play. Hey now, you're a rock star.
What are you saying, George? Do you approve?
It's one of them songs, that one, where it's
shop and take a breath.
Good, but awful at the same time.
Yeah, I agree with you there. I don't know how I feel about it. I don't know if I'd say it's awful, but it's one of those that's like so often played, you're like, fucking hell. You know, if it comes on, like you're out somewhere, you're like, come on now. But I think it's a good tune. It's one of those kind of feel good style tunes, yeah. Right? But not one that you hate because it wants to make you feel good. It's one of those that's like, embrace your flaws and all that shit, you know? So yeah, it's a good one, man, yeah.
Sweet, all right, there you go.
I love how I've done like the whole kind of history of why the band's good and all this shit. And yeah,
I like this song. I like it a lot.
I don't know what you want me to say about it. I've not looked at the history of these fucking tracks.
All right, we're ramping it up now to a song called, this is a bit of a sad one. It's a really sad one actually, called I Can Feel a Hot One by Manchester Orchestra, who by the way are not from Manchester, in case you were wondering.
What's the point?
I can just imagine Adam in the shower with a beer crying. A clean man,
alone. Just a little fart comes out.
I've shit myself.
This is me after I fail a food challenge. It's hard to get the effect of that song by just listening to a bit of it. That song is one of the best songs. Like one of the best sad songs ever written. And because I'm not a massive fan of the band. Like I liked... what the fuck is the name of that album? It might be like, I'm Like a Virgin Losing a Child, which sounds really odd. I don't know if that's the name of the album. I think I wrote that. Oh, you mean Everything to Nothing is the album that one was from. But they did have an album called that, I think. So yeah, I'm not like a huge fan of them, right? The lead singer's called Andy Hull, which I think is quite funny because they're an American band called Manchester Orchestra and the lead singer's surname is a pretty shitty British city. That rhymed? That could be an Eminem rhyme. Pretty shitty British city. Not that I meant. He's not a Cockney.
Why is he not a Cockney accent?
I don't know, because I can't do M&M's anyway. yeah, and it's about, thankfully not real, but it's about, yeah, apparently he had this really vivid dream when he was on tour about being in an accident and dying in this accident and finding out as he was dying that his wife was pregnant, because there's one lyric in the song is like, I realised then you were perfect and my teeth ripping out of my head. Oh, no, it's not that lyric. It says, oh, the Lord showed me dreams of my daughter. She was crying inside your stomach, which is it's really dark, right? But the song itself is just amazing. You notice in the beginning, it starts off with just like one single, pretty clean guitar. And then the cello comes in and it kind of gets to this really kind of emotive crescendo at the end. And because his voice is kind of quite odd, it's got that kind of shrill feel, a bit like Brian Molko from Placebo or something. It's got like a really...
Not my phone, sorry.
Like you. I thought it might be my grand trying to tell me about an ex sexual partner, but thankfully not. But yeah, it's similar. I think it makes me feel similar, I think, to the quiet things the last song that I mentioned. It's just a really sad song, and you often don't find sad, like kind of ballady numbers amongst bands like this, but when they do it, they tend to do it like really well. So yeah, if there's one song, if there's one song on this list, go listen to it. Listen to it all, but this is one that I think even people that aren't into this type of music will like and be like, oh, that's quite...
I might listen to it on my own while I cry. So the next, I'm going to try and speed this along a little bit because I can, and we've got.
It's been long as fuck.
Yeah, I've got three songs here, all from 2009, which are all absolute bangers. So we've spoken about this before. Obviously, Good Charlotte, the anthem. So that, or Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous. And then I've also got What's My Age Again by Blink, Enemy of the State, and then Fat Lip by Sum 41, all from the same year.
Your music top 15 is a perfectly analogous with your films. You basically things that songs from all those films.
Yeah, that's good, isn't it?
But those are all basically.
All the same. That's
I had alphabet in there. Who am I to say?
That's why I've thrown them all in there. I've got some curveballs coming towards the end, which I think you'll appreciate.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We've only got a few left for me. I mean, am I going then, or are you going to play any of those?
Do you want to play them?
I'll play a bit of the anthem. I think
everyone knows them, don't they? But it all feels old, it's a good life. That's what I'm told. That might be my next one. Oh,
this is the fucking shit, this one. Sing it, can you do it?
Storm into the party like my name is El Nino. I'm hanging out, drinking in the back of El Camino. As a kid, was a skid, no one knew what my name.
Just my own house party, cause nobody came.
But I know I'm not the one you thought you knew back in high school.
Never go. You're gonna be a fucking karaoke here today, boys.
I was never a huge fan of Sum 41, you know? The number band. The best part of that is when, on the video, you know, they go into Pain for Pleasure. Is that on Fat Lip? You know, when the video, it goes to end, they did the, you know, that kind of like Iron Maiden-esque Pain for Pleasure. Yeah.
Is that the one as well where they're rapping at the beginning?
Yeah, they are, yeah. They're in that shop, like. Yeah.
You know that rap that they do? That's like from a song they did for the first, like, original Spider-Man film, apparently.
Is that right?
Yeah.
We're learning today. We're learning, folks. Is it me then?
Yeah, you.
Next one. Gotta be in there. Gotta be. All Along the Watchtower, Jimi Hendrix, 1968 from Electric Ladyland.
There must be some kind of way out of here, said the Joker to the thief. There's too much confusion.
Yeah, I mean, what does that say about that? It's originally a lot of people don't know, actually. Not unlike the Leonard Cohen, Jeff Buckley one I mentioned earlier. This is a cover of a Bob Dylan song, but it sounds significantly different from the original. And yeah, it's just a fucking jam, man. It's Hendrix. If you like guitars, Hendrix is a god to you, you know?
So you could, I'm going to just destroy what you just said, but you could play that on Guitar Hero, couldn't you, back in the day?
Could you?
Yeah, it was on Guitar Hero and it was on Grand Theft Auto. So I think that's where,
I imagine you probably wouldn't play that on the hardest difficulty, would you?
No, but
it'd be quite difficult.
That's where the younger generation will recognize it from.
I never was into those games. I didn't know it was on there, to tell you the truth. But what can you say about that? It's Hendrix. It's Jimi Hendrix. If you don't know that song, you go listen to it. You should know.
Say no more then, eh? Right, this one, again, I don't know where this will land with you, but I've got a story behind this. So I'll play the song first, right? So play the song first. It's Radioactive by Imagine Dragons, 2012.
I'm waking up to ash and dust. I wipe my brow.
All right, turn it off. Look at his fucking face. What's your problem, man?
I really just don't get it. I don't know why they're like the biggest rock band in the world. I don't get it. It's like a bit. They don't sing about this. Like, there's no. To me, there's no. I don't want to criticize an artist's work, especially when it's successful as Imagine Dragons or the Imagine Dragons, whatever the fuck you call them. It doesn't do enough. It feels like I'm listening to a movie soundtrack or something. I don't.
Maybe that's why it's appealing to the masses. Then, you know, like, because I think so. That track in particular, right? When I was in Vegas in 2018. So I was there with, we were getting married, but I was there with all his family and friends. We'd been out drinking, almost like on the stag do in Vegas, and went down Fremont Street. So like old Vegas, and they've got a light show. So it's all under, have you been to Vegas?
No, never been.
So it's all under like a big canopy of a light ceiling, basically. And they do like a light show. And it's just what you'd expect of like the strip. It's all party and there's all sort of like street art going on, you know, Golden Nuggets there. It's all, and then they just switch all the lights off on this street. It goes to darkness and then that drops in and then it just plays this fucking amazing light show over your head. And I just remember it being like overwhelmingly like impressive. And that song played. And obviously like as it builds and drops,
What I'm getting from this is you were impressed by the light show. No, but I think track, the music was incidental. I think it could have been anything.
No, it fit. If I'm a fan of that.
If it was a professional light show, I'm sure it did fit to the music. That's what it's supposed to do. But I feel like it could have been any song.
No, I disagree.
All right.
I strongly disagree.
All right. This is it.
Like, let's go through the table.
I didn't think that the one that we would have such a disagreement on would be Imagine Dragons, though, which they say it's rock music. It's, I don't know. To me, it's not really rock music. But
so, yeah. Right. Do I know? That's yours. Next.
Next one is, I think, a song everyone has to know. Dexy's Midnight Runners, Come On Eileen, 1980, I'm going to guess 88.
Poor old Johnny Ray.
This song just reminds me of, like...
You fucking sugar. You and me are going to have a falling out
this
here,
this song just reminds me of every fucking party, every family party, every christening... Every wedding, every fucking working men's club I've ever been to in my life. Fucking George is nodding in the corner.
You know,
don't go to them. That's my secret.
So you can enjoy the song then? Is that why?
Yeah, I think I like that song. Probably similar, I suppose, in you were just talking about the Imagine Dragons thing. Is that song really reminds me of my dad. My dad loved that song. And
I feel bad now.
No, it's all right. But I remember him like, whenever you'd go on holiday as a kid, right? It would always be playing, right? Yeah. And I remember the first time, I still remember the first time I heard it. And I remember him being like, I think that was the first time I'd like was interested in music because I must have been like really young. I think the first time we really went on holiday somewhere was maybe when I was like 7 or something. And I remember my dad telling me what it was. And then I kind of like got into like all like kind of old music before I really got into, I was a weird kid. Right, I didn't really like...
fucking weird adult.
I wasn't listening to, you know, like your fucking Spice Girls and all that shit, you know. I listened to like stuff my dad listened to. And I remember that one. It's such a cool... it doesn't really fit in the era that it was in as well. Because they kind of really... I mean, they did obviously as Gino and everything, and they had that album, but they kind of really considered a one-hit wonders band, Dexy's Midnight Runners. Then you don't really get people that are huge fans of them. They don't have like a massive oeuvre of work, do they? But... it's so different to, you know, an era when it was like Human League. Not that there's anything wrong with that. Don't you want some gravy? But like a lot of electronica, which I think was still a cool part of the 80s music scene. And you've got this with like a violin, you've got a banjo in there, and it's all like an actual band. And I think you get the feeling that they, you know, they're like a proper old school band, like a rabble of folks that got together. And then I just think this song came out of nowhere because like, they don't really have any other, I don't want to say that they don't have any other good songs, but like this is, to me, this is like a masterpiece. Like I listen to it and I'm like, this sounds like nothing else I've ever heard in my life. It's got all these weird kind of cultural elements. You know, you can hear a bit of Irish folk in it almost, but then it's kind of punctuated by that kind of 80s rhythmic thing. And I feel bad saying it almost because it's clearly a song about him trying to get his leg over, right? Like, what is it? Come On Eileen. My thoughts I confess. Confess verge on dirty. Oh, come on, Eileen. She's obviously just begging this girl to sleep with him, which probably wouldn't float as much these days, but it's not really lyrically that the reason that I like the song. It's just a cool, I think it's just a cool tune.
I like it. It's got a good story behind it as well, mate.
There's also a band called Save Ferris, who was like, they were like a ska band. They were in 10 Things I Hate About You, quite famously, but they did a cover of it, which is like a ska punk style cover, which is really good as well. If you're into that kind of thing.
I think I can finish my list actually here because we've gone on way too long. But as I mentioned,
I've got two more
ones. You can roll your last two ones after this, and we can close the show. But I mentioned before that I were a fan of like country music. So my granddad's actually he's a musician. He does predominantly country music now. He was actually signed to the same record label as the Beatles back in the day.
So you've got no fucking excuse, have you? Yeah. You should be like, they say that apple doesn't fall far from the tree.
Oh, this one fell.
Where did the talent go? Just fucking evaporate into
miles away from the sea. But yeah, so obviously that's quite influential. Not to mention that we spent every summer growing up in Florida, so obviously in the South. But one of the songs that, so Danielle's into country music as well, and our first dance song was by a guy called Thomas Rhett. And it's the star of the show, which you've probably definitely never heard of before, but do you want to play it, George? Most people probably won't have heard of it. He's a well-known or well-recognized sort of country music artist, but I mean, the lyrics are what they are, and it's just a nice song, but he obviously that beats having like an Ed Sheeran song for your first dance, like I think everybody else in between 2017 to 2022.
Have you seen you know the song, I think it's Thinking Out Loud, and it was at a wedding, first dance or something like that, and the bride was in a wheelchair. And the first line of that song is, when your legs don't work, I think.
I've seen that, yeah, yeah.
Do you think that's supposed to, think that's intentional?
No, well, I don't know.
For the wedding?
I don't know.
That's a meme that went around on, like, did its round on Twitter.
I was thinking maybe it might be a sense of humour and just laughing about it kind of thing.
But yeah, so Thomas Rhett is obviously...
That was your first dance song?
That was our first dance song, yeah.
Oh, that's nice.
And yeah, so it's up there, one of the favourites. But like, he's up there with like, Chris Stapleton, Luke Combs, a bunch of like country music artists that you've probably never heard of. You ever heard of them? Yeah.
Yeah. Like I've heard of Chris Stapleton.
Yeah. Chris Stapleton did the song with Justin Timberlake, Say Something, that was popular like, I don't know, fucking 3 years ago, 4 years ago. Do you know it?
Say something. It's that one where there's that continuous music video where it's like.
Yeah, that's an impressive music really, video really that. It's all one continuous shot. But that's where like country music has then like come into like pop music and then gone back out.
I'm more like a Dixie Chicks kind of guy. Oh, they just call them the Chicks now, don't they? Not Dixie Chicks. Or Dolly Parton.
Dolly Parton, what a classic. A
lot of respect for Dolly Parton.
9 to 5, play that.
I think that's not her best song. But yeah, nice that, mate. Yeah, I don't mind country music.
They
call it three chords and the truth. Yeah. That's what they call it, right?
So that's something that Danielle and I can actually listen to together as far as like, it's easy listening, isn't it? It's country music.
Very easy.
It's one of those things to me that can get a bit like pungent almost. Like you're like, fucking, all right, I've had four songs.
It's a bit samey.
Yeah, they all can sound samey.
Yeah.
But
all they talk about is like beer, family, and God. Like the tractors. Yeah. Like that's it.
Bales of hay, Jesus. yeah. Right, well, like, with a slightly different. Different taste, different flavour. My second from top one is Chop Suey by System of a Down.
That's hardcore, man.
I don't think it's that hard. Fucking heavy, I could have put some harder ones in.
That the music video for this is mental and all.
I feel like you played it there and a lot that will switch a lot of people off at first listen. But that is one of the best, I think one of the best songs ever made. Because a lot of people be put off by the whole screamy, shouty, quite savage guitar work of it, you know? Because I think they were kind of lumped in with that whole new metal thing. They're not really new metal. They're all, System of a Down, the band, they're all of Armenian descent, right? Which you get a lot in the music. You get those kind of, they're not scales that you would see in like blues or rock music. They sound kind of almost culturally very different. So a lot of people listen to them like, what the fuck's this? Because they use odd time signatures and stuff like that a lot as well. But this one's kind of like the song that everyone knows, right? But I remember my dad hearing this in the car once because my dad was like super religious, right?
Yeah.
I mean, as far as Roman Catholics in England go, I mean, he's still getting drunk and probably fighting every weekend, you know? But that's probably the Irish in him. No, I'm joking. I probably cannot say that. But I remember hearing this in the car and being like, what the fuck are you listening to? Because, you know, the chorus says, angels deserve to die.
Right.
But actually what it's about, or like if you read some of the stuff around it, I think it was something like Serge Tankian, who was the lead singer, had written it, I think because he had, I think somebody who, like a kid who'd killed themselves, right, out of depression because they were bullied or whatever, in like a Bible Belt America town. I could be totally off the mark here, tell me in the comments if I am. But I read this somewhere and like it was about, because of this, how austere all the, you know, it's deeply entrenched in middle America where everyone's really, really religious. And they were all saying, you know, it's God's will. And they were saying it's a good thing that this person killed themselves. And so he wrote this about the community saying, Angel in the lyric is the kid, you know, saying they deserve to die because of, you know, they were different or whatever. And they ended up killing themselves. It's something like that, I think I've read. So it's actually not a song that's like anti-religion or anything, or like anti Christianity. It's just about you know, how people can affected by some religious ideology can turn on somebody who's innocent, who's at their last thread, you know, and the only way out for this kid was to kill themselves, they thought, you know. So it's kind of a sad song, but there's an interesting part about that, the bit where he says, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit, which is like Jesus on the cross, right?
Yeah.
And the guy that the sound engineer, I forget his name now, oh man, it'll come to me. But he was, they'd not fully written the song, they started recording it. And he couldn't get the bridge part, like that pre-chorus part. So he sent him into his library, this sound engineer at his home where his studio was. And Serge Tankian picked up like the Bible and he read this passage from it and he just put it in the song. And he was like, how mad is that? That this kind of, you know, everything comes together. But yeah, I mean, it's to me, that's like a flawless song. It's got like really kind of heavy, brutal guitar work at the beginning, the shouting, the screaming and all that. But then it's quite melodic as well. And I just think it's an amazing song. Admittedly, not everyone can enjoy it, but if you like music with guitars, then you're probably going to like it.
You a fan of that, George?
Yeah. I used to, when I was a kid, my dad would pick me up from school for the weekend. He was just moshing the car to that. Bang.
Your dad was into System of a Down?
He was into all sorts. He was into Blink-182 and rock, pop, punk.
George gigs with his dad now. They still do that now.
That must be rocking. My dad liked music, but like I think he always wanted to play him, an instrument, but like he never did. In fact, because he was like notorious a bit of a tight ass. And I actually recently told my sister that the second guitar I got, my dad bought it for me, not for like any occasion. And my sister was getting mad. She was like, the fuck, you never bought me anything like outside birthday and Christmas. I was like, I think it's because he wanted to live through me a bit, you know, he saw me playing guitar and whatnot. But that's mad that it must be cool, like gigging with your dad and whatnot. I saw a dude from Mystery Jets, which of course I covered for the Garlic Bread song. His dad gigs with them now, but like at a point, I think the bassist had left or something. So he had to get his dad to sit in, which I thought was really cool.
That's cool, yeah.
I bet people at the time didn't think it was cool, like playing with your dad, but I think that's cool.
What's your top one then? What's your number one song?
Top one, I think almost unrivaled, is a song called Lua by Bright Eyes. It's Lua, if you're looking for it, George.
Supplies are endless in the evening. By the morning, they'll be gone.
Basically just goes on like that for 4 minutes. So I mean, you know.
I would have never have guessed that would be your number one song.
Yeah,
like what a fucking day this has been.
I mean, it probably depends on what day you catch me on as to what my I can't really do it in order, because like that's just not a song you'd listen to if you want to feel happy, right?
Yeah.
But Conor Oberst, who wrote some wildly complex songs when he was like 19 18, I think is when he got started. And yeah, Bright Eyes is one of those bands that I think I don't understand why everyone doesn't. I get why everyone doesn't like them, because it's a bit kind of, it's all quite depressing music. But yeah, it's just that it's folk music, really. I think Bright Eyes, his voice is unique, right? But he's not probably the most gifted singer of all time. He's not listening to me sing or something. But like the lyricism is just unreal. It's like your kind of modern day, like poetry and stuff that, like, I reckon like 50 years kids will study that at school, or I would hope that they do anyway, because it's just, I think, amazing. He talks about like all kinds of stuff, like drug abuse and like depression and really uplifting things, you know. But that's the song again. It's like storytelling, you know. It's like an old folks, it's like a folk song, but supplanted into a 21st century environment. It's talk about going to a party at an actor's loft, but it's all so vivid you can kind of like picture it, and about like him getting pissed on a night and then in the morning being fucked up, and which doesn't sound that uplifted, but it's good. I mean, just listen to that's from the album I'm Wide Awake, It's Morning, and I think everyone should listen to that album at least once in their life. You'll enjoy it. It's not got like lots of heavy guitars, no screaming, so you'll be all right.
What a fucking interesting podcast this has been, you know. If you've made it this far, thank you so much for listening or watching, and let us know what you think in the comments below. Who had the best list? Was it what you expected or wasn't it? And put some of your favourites down there, some classics that we might be a fan of, and we might read out in the comments next time.
Yeah, we got guests next week, so you don't have to listen to us talking nonsense for 90 minutes.
Right, catch you to the next one.
I don't think you trust in my...
What was that?